Well, hi. I need to tell you that I'm recording a few of these chapters ahead of time. David will have been here and arrived yesterday, and we will have had all kinds of fun already. But I'm recording this so that I can spend the maximum amount of time with him and still spend the maximum amount of time with you. So let's go to it. Chapter 4, The First Harbinger, The Breach. But did you see the prophet after that? Yes. And you didn't have any contact with him before you saw him again? That's right. I don't understand. How did you know where to meet him or when, if he never told you? I didn't know where or when. We just met. Well, I still don't get it. It would just happen. Sometimes I'd be led by the clues. Sometimes I'd be led in spite of them. Even when I got them wrong, I'd still end up in the right place eventually. And sometimes, even with no clues, when I wasn't even searching, it would still happen. We just ended up in the same place. Call it predestination. I don't know, it just happened. Well, why do you think the prophet gave you clues to put together instead of just telling you from the start? I don't know. Maybe because it was the process of trying to put it all together that led to the next encounter. I think it was also so that each harbinger would be burned into my consciousness. So you met him again. And what happened? No, wait a minute. She got up from the table, walked over to her desk, and pressed one of the buttons on her phone set. Hold off any incoming calls, she said. Don't allow any interruptions. Even the calls that are scheduled? Replied a woman's voice on the speakerphone. Yes. Tell them something came up and that I'll get back to them as soon as possible. Apologize for me warmly. For how long? I don't know. For the rest of the day. She returned to the table and refocused her attention. Okay, so you met him again. When and where? Well, it was weeks after our last encounter. During that time, I studied the seal, looking for clues to the mystery of the first harbinger. And what was on it? Markings and shapes, but one that was clearly the central image and largest. It was, how can I describe it? There was a horizontal line, as if it was the top border of some object or structure. The line dipped down in the middle of the seal, then back up again, then continued as a horizontal line to the other side, so it formed something like a V in the middle. I couldn't make anything out of it. So I went back to the bench by the water. But he wasn't there. I went back several more times after that, but nothing. More weeks went by, then months. I wondered if I'd ever see him again. And the whole thing still didn't seem real. I would have almost doubted my memory if it wasn't for the seal. One day, it was a Tuesday morning, I was in Lower Manhattan, the very bottom of the island in Battery Park, pondering the words of the prophet and looking across the waters at the Statue of Liberty in the distance. At first I didn't notice it, a dark figure standing about 50 feet in front of me and to the right. It was him. He was also facing the water, so I could only see his back. Whether he was looking at the statue or some other object, or just at the water, I don't know. He turned to the side just for a moment. That's when I recognized him. I made my way over to him as fast as I could, not wanting to risk missing the moment. While I was still in back of him, he spoke. Again, without breaking his gaze, at least at first. Noriel, he said. Present, I replied. And just on time. Did you arrange that too? No. Have you studied the seal? I have. And what did you find? Nothing. Did you bring your recorder? It's always with me. Then let's begin, he said, turning to gaze toward me for the first time in the exchange. A warm breeze ruffled his hair as he spoke above the sound of seagulls in the background. Take out the seal. What do you see? Inscriptions, symbols, and one main symbol. What do you make of it? I don't know. It's something like a V. It's an image, Noriel. Of what? The top of a wall. It's a wall of protection. And what's the V in the middle? Well, it's not a V. A breach. A breach. A gap, a break, an opening in the wall. The wall is broken, the sign that an enemy has entered it. It's the removing of the hedge of protection. It's what happened to ancient Israel. Yes, with no other way of getting through to them, the hedge of protection is removed. The year is 732 BC. Israel's enemies invade the land and wreak havoc. The calamity traumatizes the nation, but it takes place on a limited scale. The enemy strikes and then withdraws. It's a foreshadowing of something much greater and much more severe. A warning. A harbinger of a future judgment so great that if it ever came to pass, the nation would never recover. So the warning is the removal of the hedge. Yes, said the prophet. A late-stage warning allowed to take place only when nothing else would wake them up. Limited, restrained, the sound of an alarm for the purpose of averting a much greater calamity. It never could have happened had Israel remained inside the will of God. No enemy could have ever breached its walls, but outside the will of God. Any notion of national security or invincibility was an illusion. The breach exposed it. The nation was in danger. It would be shaken to its foundation. And apart from returning to God, there was no wall strong enough to protect them. It was their wake-up call. So they never woke up. Nope. Most would see the tragedy as a matter of defense, national security, or foreign policy. They committed themselves to making sure it would never happen again. They fortified their defenses, strengthened their walls, and formed strategic alliances. Few of them pondered the possibility that there could be any deeper significance behind it. And yet the voices of their prophets, the words of their scriptures, and an uneasy stirring in their hearts were all warning them that something was wrong. The nation had departed from God. But apart from the prophets, few realized the critical line they had crossed and the new and dangerous era they had entered. No political or military power would be strong enough to ensure their safety. Only a return to God. The attack was a warning and a harbinger of judgment. So, what happened after they missed their wake-up call? As time passed, it appeared as if life was gradually returning to normal. There was a respite peace. With every passing year, it seemed as if the danger was farther behind them. But it was an illusion. The problem was, and the danger was only increased. It was a period of grace given to them in mercy that they might change their course and avert the judgment. But if not, the greater judgment would come. And that first breaching of their walls would be remembered as the harbinger that was the beginning of their fall. These were the most critical of days. The seal Noriel handed to me. So I gave it to him. He lifted it up in his right hand. "The first harbinger," he said, holding this seal level with my eye. "The breach. The nation that had long known blessing and security witnesses the failure of its defenses. Its walls of protection are broken through. Its national security is breached, and its illusion of invincibility shattered. The days of the harbingers begin." And this has something to do with America. America was the most blessed nation on earth. As blessings shielded by a powerful hedge of national protection. As its founders had foretold, if the nation followed the ways of God, it would be blessed not only with prosperity and power, but also with peace and security. But if America turned away from God, his protection would be removed. Excuse me. Yes. And so it did. And so it was. His hedge of protection was removed, and his walls were breached. His walls were breached when? The prophet was silent, as if waiting for me to say it, or waiting for it to hit me, and then it did. All at once. September 11th. Yes. The first harbinger. The breach. The nation that had so long known the blessings of peace and security witnesses its walls of protection broken through as its defenses fail. On September 11th, 2001, the walls of America's national security was breached. "It happened right there," he said, pointing to the sky above the waters. "The second attack, that's how it came. The most powerful nation on earth and the most sophisticated defense system ever built by man. Its walls of defense breached." "And then came the mistake," he said. "Then came the repeating of the ancient mistake. America responded to the calamity as if it were only a matter of security and defense, and nothing more. It would strengthen its national defenses and fortify its walls of protection. There was no pausing to ponder whether there could be anything of deeper significance behind it, no asking if something could be wrong, no searching of its ways. Was God behind it? Man was behind it. Evil men were behind it. Up to that point, they had been restrained, but that restraint would have to have limits. As with the attack on ancient Israel, an attack would now be allowed on American soil. But it was planned by evil men. It was evil. Yes, but God can cause that which is evil to work for good. But what good? the sounding of an alarm, to wake up a sleeping nation, to change its course, to save it from judgment. But then, was God with America's enemies? Oh, no, 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 no more than he was with those who attacked ancient Israel. Those who do such things are his enemies as well. God was against those who attacked America and would deal with them just as he dealt with the enemies of ancient Israel. And what about those who perished? When calamity came to ancient Israel, both the righteous and the unrighteous were touched by it. Both perished alike. The judgment was upon the nation, but that the innocent and righteous also perished in those calamities was not a matter of judgment, but of sorrow. But for the nation, the fact that such calamities could have happened in the first place was a matter of both warning and judgment. Each took place in its own realm. So it was with 9/11. The calamity took place in two different realms, the private realm of individuals and the public realm of the nation. In the first realm is only sorrow, and the magnitude of the calamity is secondary. And for those touched by it, the loss of one life is the loss of an entire world. The charge here is to bind up the broken, to comfort, to support, and to never forget the wounded and the bereaved. But the second realm is distinct and separate, centering not on the individual, but on the nation as a whole. It is in the second realm that the matter of judgment remains. It's hard to receive. Could you receive it from another? What do you mean? Abraham Lincoln. What does he have to do with? Do you know how many lives were lost in the American Civil War? I have no idea. Thousands. Hundreds of thousands. And Lincoln spoke of the calamity devastating the nation as the judgment of a righteous God, not on in any individual, but on the nation as a whole. Oh, but it's a hard... Of course it is, as it was for Isaiah and Jeremiah and all the prophets and others who wept and cried out for their people. But if we fail to consider the possibility, if we avoid addressing the issue, do we not then become accountable for what follows? For what follows? I don't know. But even to say, God allowed it to happen. It happened, Noriel. Therefore, it had to have been allowed to happen. That's not the question. Rather, the only question is whether it was allowed to happen for no reason or whether there was within it a redemptive purpose. On 9/11, people were asking, where was God? Where was God? He said, as if surprised by the question. We drove him out of our schools, out of our government, and out of our media, not... at all caring. We drove him out of our culture, out of our public square. We drove him out of our national life, and then we ask, where is God? And he wasn't there. Still he was there. He was there and with those who lost their loved ones and is still there to heal the broken and comfort those who mourn. He was there with those who gave their lives so others could live, shadows of him. And he was there as well with all the countless others who would have perished that day if not for the countless turns of details and events that saved them. And for those who perished, those who were with God in life are now with him in eternity. For these, it was not a day of national calamity, but of release. He was with them and is with them. You said something about what happened in ancient Israel after the attack, that things began to return to normal. I spoke of things appearing to return to normal. There's a difference. So was the hedge of protection back in place? To a degree, and for a time, but the danger was still there. And what about America after 9/11? I asked. In the months and years after 9/11, it appeared likewise as if things had returned to this some state of normalcy. As time passed, as the initial shock wore off and the trauma lessened, there was a growing temptation to go on almost as if it had never happened, as if the nation were still somehow immune to destruction. And so it was in the last days of ancient Israel. But it was an illusion. There was a long silence after that, broken only by the sound of the seagulls. And then he continued, as if there had been no break. It was all a fatal illusion. So then, what of America? I didn't answer him. I don't believe he was expecting me to. After posing the question, he reached into his coat pocket to reveal another seal, which he placed into my hand. "The seal of the second harbinger," he said. "And what did it look like?" asked Anna. "Overall, like the others, except for the images." "Which were?" "Figures." "Of what? Of men?" "What kind of men?" I had no idea. I tried to get him to tell me by asking, "So what am I looking at?" "It's not so hard," he replied. "Give me a clue, something." "Until next time, Nuriel." And with that, he began to walk away. "When? Next time? Where?" "The same time and place," he said again, without stopping to look back. "Here." "No." "Then where and when?" "Wherever and whenever. Just be sure to be there." "At least give me a clue to help me unlock the seal." "By the ruins of an ancient people." "Is that the clue?" I shouted after him. "Or is that where we're supposed to meet?" "Ah, but that would require another clue," he shouted back. "Another clue? Then it was a clue about the second harbinger and not about where we're supposed to meet," I shouted back. "Perhaps, and perhaps not," he replied. He wasn't easy that way, but it was enough for me to begin searching for the meaning behind the second harbinger, a mystery to be found somewhere by the ruins of an ancient people. And that's the end of chapter 4. The fifth chapter tomorrow is called The Second Harbinger, The Terrorist. And I want to conclude by just mentioning something you may not know. That is that my daughter Beth was scheduled to be at the Pentagon right in the section that received an airplane. And just before she left to go there in the morning, one of her five children wasn't feeling well. So she postponed going. And she's alive today. Praise God. Wonder how many stories of that kind people could tell who would have been there except for some strange reason they weren't. Tomorrow we'll get together again and we'll look at the fifth chapter, the second harbinger, the terrorist. I'm going to go play more with David now. Hallelujah.